August 2nd, 1990. Saddam Hussein's forces crashed through the defenses of oil-rich Kuwait. In fear of an Iraqi invasion into Saudi Arabia, the United States and her coalition allies poured into the Arabian Peninsula to form a deterrent that would be known as Desert Shield. The result was a series of diplomatic talks, negotiations, and counter-negotiations that rapidly declined into a no-hope situation. On August 17, 1991, Desert Shield became Desert Storm. The conflict was witnessed by millions through the eye of CNN and the BBC, showing propaganda of the systematic eradication of Saddam's forces by a coalition far superior in technological, political, and economic power. However, what was little known was that from the outset the war was engineered, controlled, and manipulated by an elite group. A group which had created the illusion of a man with power, at the head of a million-strong army, on the verge of going nuclear. A man who had gained control over one-fifth of the world's oil overnight. However, in reality, he was merely a pawn, in amongst many pawns, just a puppet in a grand master plan, with the Gulf War as a well-orchestrated stepping stone. The orchestrators of the war were by no means strangers to controlling major world events. In fact, they have done so for centuries. From the shadows, they have engineered every major war, revolution, and recession. They control everything you read, everything you hear, and everything you see. They have managed to indoctrinate an entire populace to their way of thinking, and have infiltrated key positions in places of authority. And it is from the shadows that they have created a new political order, a new economic order, and more sinister, a new religious order. Their ultimate aim is total global domination, and they will stop at nothing to reach their goal. The goal that was outlined in a speech given by former President of the United States, George Bush.
What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order.
However, the origins of this global plan were not created in the offices of the White House. In reality, their roots lay in another war. This time, the year is 1095, and the place, Clermont, France. Del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. 11th century Europe was ruled by the Church, which held a firm grip on the hearts and minds of the people. This power enabled Pope Urban II to wage war on the Muslim Caliphate and crusade in what he called a War of the Cross to recapture the land of Jerusalem. It had been under Muslim rule since the year 637, but in 1099 this rule was brought to a bloody and sudden end. In the name of the cross, women were raped and murdered. Children were put to the sword, and it is said that blood ran in the streets knee-high to the horses. Out of this land of bloodshed and terror, a group of men arose. Men that would stop at nothing to get what they wanted, no matter what the cost. 20 years after Jerusalem was taken, the Dome of the Rock was seized by a group of warrior monks calling themselves the Knights of the Temple of Solomon, or more simply, the Knights Templars. In Jerusalem, the Templars began to deviate further and further away from the practices of Christianity. They learnt the secret arts of the Kabbalah, an ancient form of Jewish magic, along with its dark rites and rituals. The Jews had learnt the arts from the pagans of ancient Egypt during the times of enslavement to the Pharaoh and developed them into Babylon at the time of Nebuchadnezzar. In 1307, King Philip of France arrested them for charges of denial of Christ, worship, as well as magic. In 1314, Pope Clement V declared all Templars as heretics to Christianity, ordering all their properties to be seized. Their leader, Jacques de Morlaix, was captured and burnt to the stake. The Templars were cornered, and just when it seemed they were finished forever, a glimmer of hope arose from a seemingly certain end. They were to find a safe haven as well as an ally. But not in France. In fact, in a country in a desperate struggle for independence against the English. The country of Scotland. For some, Scotland's hope of independence had died with the death of William Wallace. However, to the King of Scotland, Robert the Bruce, the arrival of the Templars gave him a new secret weapon. Their experience, gained over 200 years of fighting the mighty armies of Islam, had made them expert in combat and warfare, and more than a match for any army brought before them. In 1314, the Templars, allied with Robert the Bruce and his army, took to the fields of Bannockburn in the long-awaited showdown with the English. Robert the Bruce's foresight paid off. The 25,000-strong English army suffered a humiliating defeat at the hands of only 6,500 men. The dream of an independent Scotland had finally been achieved. The Templars had brought themselves back from the brink of destruction, and never again would they allow themselves to be destroyed. This time, they would control the country by controlling its kings. And in order to preserve their secret order, the Templars would have to die. Or more precisely, the name would have to die. The Templars, who had escaped Europe, were finally laid to rest in Roslyn Chapel, Scotland, which stands to this day as sign of their presence in Britain. Their descendants became the true power of Scotland. In 1603, the death of Queen Elizabeth I left England without an heir to the throne. By virtue of descent, King James V of Scotland became King of England. In doing so, Scotland and England joined to form a new kingdom, and the power that the Templars held over Scotland spread to give them a firm grip on the whole of Great Britain. For over 100 years, the Templars concealed their activities, fading into the background until they were little known and little remembered. However, they did not cease to keep a firm grip on Britain. All the time they were planning, regrouping, and infiltrating positions of power in all corners of the kingdom. In 1717, the Templars made their reappearance in Europe. They had grown in both number and strength, and were now ready to coin a new identity, free from their reputation of the past, and given credibility by none other than the monarchy and aristocracy of England. And the name they chose for themselves was a name that would be known by many, but understood by a few. This new name, the Freemasons. The new identity and the grandeur of its members afforded the Masons with respect and dignity. The first royal member of the Freemasons was Frederick, Prince of Wales. The latest members include Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh, and consort to the current Queen of England, Elizabeth II, who herself is a grand patron to the Masons. However, behind closed doors, the Freemasons were free to indulge in the secret rites and rituals handed down to them by their ancestors. And these became the basis of their levels of membership, called degrees. The Freemasons were not content with power in Britain alone. Their ambitions were far greater. In the years to come, the world would witness Europe and America being plagued by wars and revolutions, each more devastating than the other. However, these would not be as commonly believed, the spontaneous effects of a downtrodden people, but in fact schemes created by the exclusive few, driven by hunger for absolute power. All this would take place from the very country from which they had fled centuries earlier, and would become the base for their global domination.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order.
Satan does have plans for a one world government, and you have to control the money.
The United States presidents have blood relations with each other. The Bush lineage has blood ties to a great number of former presidents. George Washington, Millard Fillmore, Franklin Pierce, Abraham Lincoln, Ulysses Grant, Rutherford Hayes, James Garfield, Grover Cleveland, Teddy Roosevelt, William Taft, Calvin Coolidge, Herbert Hoover, Franklin Roosevelt, Richard Nixon, and Gerald Ford. Sarion points out in his work that Bush is closely related to every European monarch on and off the throne. and has kinship with every member of Britain's royal family. Bush's family tree can be documented as far back as the early 15th century. He has a direct descent from Henry III and from Henry VIII's sister Mary Tudor. He is also descended from Charles II of England. And we also find that George W. Bush is a direct descendant of Godfrey de Bouillon. Godfrey was the first king of Jerusalem after he recaptured it from the Saracens, which was the name for the Islamic faith during the Middle Ages. It is interesting to note that the current occupation of the United States in the Middle East was re-established by the same family, George Bush Sr. in 1991 and again by George Bush Jr. in 2003. George Bush Jr. is then found to be a cousin to both opposing candidates of his two terms in office, Al Gore and John Kerry. Democratic President Barack Obama also has blood ties with George W. Bush, as well as Gerald Ford, Lyndon Johnson, Harry Truman, James Madison, and the British Prime Minister Sir Winston Churchill. On the opposing side of the 2008 presidential ballot, John McCain is descended from Robert the Bruce, King William I of Scotland, and also Godfrey de Bouillon.
In either of those first two books, though, who knew? You and Dick Cheney cousins?
You know, listen, I don't think I'm going to family reunion. I don't know how I'll be greeted.
We all know his father, but what about his cousins? A heartbeat away from the presidency is actually a blood relation. He's President Bush's ninth cousin once removed. Cheney's cousin Barack Obama is also Bush's 11th cousin. President Lincoln was President Bush's 7th cousin 5 times removed. And Bush shared more than just a ballot with John Kerry. That's right, they're 9th cousins twice removed. Trace the family tree far enough and you get Madonna, Celine Dion.
I opposed this war in 2002.
But do you know their relatives? Obama is distantly related to 6 presidents, George W. and George H.W. Bush, Gerald Ford, Lyndon Johnson, Harry S. Truman, and James Madison. Obama's family tree also includes Sir Winston Churchill and Civil War General Robert E. Lee.
Thank you all. Thank you.
She's also related to beatnik author Jack Kerouac and the wife of Prince Charles of England. John McCain's ancestry was more difficult to trace, but it's known he's the 6th cousin of First Lady Laura Bush.
Illuminized Masonic symbolism is all over America. On the back of the dollar bill on the left-hand side above the pyramid, it says Anuit Coeptus, which means our enterprise is now a success, or a crowned success. So what enterprise does it mean? Well, Novus Ordo Seclorum near the bottom. Novus meaning new, Ordo is order, Seclorum is where we get our word secular, meaning the world. So it means new order of the world, simply new world order. So what it's saying is the New World Order is now a crowned success. This was put on the dollar bill in 1934. 1934 is when the Federal Reserve took total control of the United States monetary system. The Fed is essentially controlled by two Illuminati bloodlines, the Rothschilds and the Rockefellers. President Franklin D. Roosevelt, a 32nd degree Scottish Rite Mason, placed the seal on the dollar bill. Roosevelt was also in the Order of the Nobles of the Mystic Shrine, known for its satanic rituals. The pyramid has 13 steps. In fact, the number 13 is on the bill everywhere. 13 leaves on the olive branch. 13 berries. 13 stripes on the shield. 13 arrows. 13 stars. 13 letters on E Pluribus Unum. And 13 letters in Anuit Coeptus. Now, some people believe 13 is on the bill due to the 13 colonies. But dig a little bit deeper and you'll find the real answer. 13 also represents the 13 top Illuminati families that he traced back to the late 18th century and the early 19th century. He is credible, and that's why he was framed by the government and thrown in a cage. 1776 is in Roman numerals near the bottom. Some think it's because of the founding of the country. Another case of subliminal indirect reverse psychological propaganda. 1776 is when the Illuminati was formed. The New World Order. Another striking fact is that the eagle has 32 feathers on the right wing, the number of ordinary degrees of the Scottish Rite. There's 33 feathers on the left wing, representing the 33rd degree. The tail has 9 feathers, which represents the 9th degree of the York Rite. The eagle itself is a prominent icon in masonry, extensively used in the Scottish Rite.
Plato's Republic in the 1500s was popular work. He said, if we could have a group of wise men who were well paid to rule over the people, then there would be no corruption. And so they had to go into a secret society.
It's estimated close to 5 million men are involved in Freemasonry here in North America.
It is based on the worship of the male regenerative power.
They were highly skilled men, and they wanted to keep the secrets of their skills to themselves.
They are then required to take a blood oath not to reveal the secrets of masonry, or they will lose their life.
And I was warned that should I reveal any of the secrets of Freemasonry, to know what to expect.
I went in there with all good intentions, thinking I was entering a fraternity.
He does not know at all what he is being initiated into. It's not even mentioned.
And they get into it naively, not realizing that it is a religious organization designed for very specific spiritual purposes.
I thought it was a Christian organization.
Their own leaders have consciously lied and deceived to them because they do not want them to know the true teachings of Masonry.
It is based on Egyptian paganism.
They are in a non-Christian pagan idolatrous cult.
Freemasonry goes so far as to actually call Lucifer God.
And no Christian has any part in it.
Now, the elite of the world, such as Bilderbergers, high-level Masons, CFR attendees, and Trilateral Commission attendees, all meet up with each other once a year at a place called the Bohemian Grove. The Grove is a 2,700-acre secluded area in the woods of Montreal, California. The fact is, there is irrefutable evidence that satanic ritual goes on inside the Bohemian Grove. Here is a photo of Masonic coffin ritual being performed in front of a shrine of the devil. Now, a documentary filmmaker and radio talk show host from Austin, Texas, Alex Jones, snuck into the Bohemian Grove in the year 2000 and filmed this satanic ritual known as the Cremation of Care. Notice the 50-foot stone idol. Notice the red, black, and white robes. Notice the fire and the satanic sacrifice. Now, there's a debate on what the idol represents. One camp says it's Moloch, the god of child sacrifice in the Old Testament, due to the nature of the ritual and the sacrifice near the belly of the idol. But in my research, I found that it is not actually Moloch. The owl is a symbol of Minerva. You see, Dionysus of ancient owl. Similarly, child sacrifice was also involved in this cult. The owl became an important Illuminati symbol in 1776 and was adapted to the name of the Illuminati degree known as Minervals. In Abe Barrel's book, Memoirs Illustrating the History of Jacobinism, published in 1798, page 582, he writes, quote, Vicept had adopted the bird of the night as his emblem, unquote. The owl represents wisdom, so what the elite are doing here is sacrificing something to Minerva, the owl of wisdom, and at the same time getting rid of their conscience and their care. Genesis 2:9 tells us that the tree of knowledge to which the deceitful serpent falsely attributed the power. So the elite want the knowledge that God is not willing to give them, and they are willing to do satanic sacrifice to the false god of wisdom, the owl Minerva, who is in turn the serpent or the devil who offers knowledge. What kind of knowledge could they want? Maybe they want to know how to complete the New World Order Vicep started. Either way, Moloch or Minerva worship is satanic. They both have child sacrifice. They're wearing black, red, and white cloaks and practicing idol worship. This Minerva is Satan in disguise. The owl at the grove is further proof that the Illuminati lives on, since Vicep adopted the symbol of the owl from ancient Greece.
Listen, I am a happy member of the Bohemian Grove. I like the folks who come there, and it's really inappropriate for me to talk about the group beyond that.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
Frankly, I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about. You have this is what's called ambush journalism, and I disrespect you for that as well. So thank you and goodbye. It's none of your damn business.
Many people who attend the Bohemian Grove are on the news every day, leading double lives. Some of these people include George W. Bush, George H. W. Bush.
What do you want me to talk about? The Bohemian Club. Did you say the Bohemian Club? I've never been to the Bohemian Club, but you ought to go. It'd be good for you. Get some fresh air.
Here's a New Statesman news report that tells us that Bill Clinton has gone to the Bohemian Grove. Bill Clinton is a lying piece of garbage.
كذا فيها خط على شيء معين حول رقم واحد يوجد شكل زخرفي. هذا الشكل الزخرفي مكبر بجوار الصورة هكذا يرى المشاهد شيء يشبه وجه البومة.
نعم.
سنقول له ما هي هذه البومة. هذه البومة هي ليليث. ما هي ليليث؟
نعم.
ليليث هذه في سفر زهار في هناك سفر في التلمود اسمه زهار أو سفر الإشراق أو الضياء يقول أن هناك
نعم.
وفي الحركات السرية هي والماسونية هي رمز للتمرد على السلطات وعلى القيود وعلى التقاليد وعلى رجال الأديان وعلى العقائد وهكذا.
You were both in Skull and Bones, the secret society.
It's so secret we can't talk about it.
What does that mean for America?
Also in the street plan of Washington, you find pentagrams. So here we have two pentagrams in the street plan of Washington. The top one points into the Capitol building, and the one at the bottom points into the White House. This is a political building, so we're told. In fact, it's a temple to a secret society, built by the Freemasons to a specific design, Congress, the Congress building. Where did it get its name from? Capitol Hill. From a sacred place of the Roman Brotherhood going way back called Capitoline Hill. And when Madeleine Albright, high priestess of this Brotherhood, became Secretary of State, and she went across on her first overseas visit to Europe. She actually went to Rome and made an official visit at what for her would have been a pilgrimage to Capitoline Hill in Rome. And that's where we get Capitol Hill from. This is George Washington. In the last century, they decided they didn't have a decent statue of George. So instead of getting an American to produce one, they ordered it from Italy, from Florence. And when it arrived on the dockside, people were staggered because here was George, the first president of the United States, depicted naked from the waist up with this cloth over his Bill Clinton's and then pointing up one arm, pointing down the other. What's going on? Unless you realize where these people are coming from, it's inexplicable. Well, if you just hold that in your mind, arm up, arm down, naked from the waist up, and then Bill Clinton's covered in a piece of cloth, well, this is where it's coming from. This is the ancient depiction of the compilation of the negative force symbol that the Templars worshipped, or the high-level Templars worshipped anyway, called Baphomet. And this is why that they depicted George Washington in that way.
is a global network of witch covens, black magicians, and Freemasons. They use a secret code of numbers and words to communicate the plan to one another. They hold rituals right in the heart of the British Parliament and Washington, D.C. The Illuminati have designed the United States as the headquarters for their barbarous plan to bring about the apocalyptic prophecies of the Antichrist.
They have a lot to respond to the fact that I am past master of my lodge and a Freemason, and I'm very proud of the fact. And I think it's interesting to listen to a debate that says that points toward Freemasonry as an occult, when 36 of the 50 signers of the Declaration of Independence, all of the generals in Washington's army, and everyone who's participated in the Revolutionary War, were basically Freemasons. And if you look at how the foundation of the country was put together, it's on Masonic principles. So I think it's certainly an interesting debate that's probably not appropriate in this public forum, but I would certainly encourage people that have a different viewpoint to study the Freemasonry organization more closely.
Let him who hath understanding reckon the number of the beast.
For it is a human number.
Its number is 666.
Thousands of years, the holy lands of the Middle East have run with blood. Here, the scars of battle fought between three of the great religions of the world are etched into the earth. But the deepest wound was made by a war between Christian and Muslim, begun at the close of the 11th century and fought for 200 years. A tiny strip of land just a few hundred miles long, but with the greatest prize, Jerusalem.
great industrial powers are locked in mortal combat. Millions are dying in the trenches in Europe, but the consequences of the war are felt around the globe. The old semi-feudal Ottoman Turkish Empire, already shaken by nationalist revolution in 1908, is falling to pieces. And disastrously, it's allied to Germany. The British and French are out to make the most of the collapse of the Ottoman Empire in the Middle East, and the British are out to protect the roots to the jewel in the crown, the British Empire in India. The British will promise anything to anyone if they think it will help them win the war. In 1915, Sir Henry McMahon, the British High Commissioner in Cairo, wants to encourage an Arab revolt against the Ottoman Empire. He writes to Sharif Hussein, "As for the regions lying within the proposed frontiers, in which Great Britain is free to act without detriment to her ally, France, I am authorized to give you the following pledges on behalf of the government of Great Britain, and to reply to your note as follows. Great Britain is prepared to recognize and uphold the independence of the Arabs in all the regions lying within the frontiers proposed by the Sharif of Mecca." A year later, T. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia, writes an intelligence note to his British commanders and encourages them to take the same course. He says it will be beneficial to us because it marches with our immediate aims: the breakup of the Islamic bloc, the defeat and disruption of the Ottoman Empire, and because the states that Sharif Hussein would set up to succeed the Turks would be harmless to ourselves. The Arabs are even less stable than the Turks, and if properly handled, they would remain in a state of political mosaic, a tissue of small, jealous principalities incapable of cohesion.
When Britain left the Holy Land, she left like a thief in the dark. For the first time, for the only time in British history, there was no legal transfer of power from Britain to the successor state. In 1948, Britain acted as a midwife for the baby to be born. The European Jewish state of Israel. And to cause that state of Israel to become the ruling state in the world. Which island is it? An amazing thing has happened. The British government did something which was incredibly strange and mysterious. If Britain, which is now the prince of the secular world, the secular world takes religion out of politics, and Britain is the prince of the secular world, Britain issues a declaration known as the Balfour Declaration. In November 1917, that it is the intention of His Majesty's government to work for the establishment of a Jewish national home in the Holy Land. Do you hear that? The only thing stranger than that that ever occurred in history was the day that the cow jumped over the moon. Why would a secular state, which leads the world of secular states, declare its intention to work for the establishment of a Jewish national home, meaning a Jewish state, in the Holy Land? 2 months later, this was October 1917, in December 1917, it is a British army led by General Allenby which defeats the Ottoman Islamic army and liberates the Holy Land. And when Allenby entered into Jerusalem,
the British general declared, "Today, the Crusades are over." Oh, but the Crusades were supposed to have been Christian wars. And you are now a secular state. You're not a Christian state, you're a secular state. How come is secular Britain is continuing a crusade started by the Pope 1,000 years before? That's strange. That is incredibly strange. Between 1918 and 1948, it is the island of Britain which ruled over the Holy Land on a mandate conferred by the League of Nations. And during that period of time, Britain opened the doors for the Jews of Europe to enter into the Holy Land and to reclaim it as their own. But now, the United States takes over from Britain as the new ruling state in the world. In the same way that Britain had a mysterious relationship with the Holy Land and with the Jews, the United States now has that mysterious relationship with the Holy Land and with the Jews. The first country in the world to recognize the State of Israel is the United States of America. Is that by accident? We are located at that moment in time when a day which is like a month is about to...
صحيح هذه شعوب العالم في بوتقتها الأخلاقية والقانونية والأزياء والذي اسمه العولمة التي نعيشها الآن. فطبعا الخطاب كما قلنا يعني مر علينا أكثر من 140 سنة واقترب من هذا، ففي تقريبا يعني مسار الأحداث في كل القرن العشرين.
Was adopted by 33 votes, 13 against, 10 abstentions.
Not later than May 16th next, a provisional Jewish government will commence to function in cooperation with the representatives of the United Nations then in Palestine.
When they colonize
a part of the world. They do not leave, they do not decolonize until and unless they have put in place institutions which will ensure that that society will continue to be ruled by them, and in the process they seek to transform the rest of mankind into carbon copies of themselves. This never happened before in history. Understand what's happening here? Then I've got peanuts in my head. When will I wake up?
Muhammad said that a time would come when the whole world would gather around to plan the destruction of the Muslims, as if they were gathered around a table to take part in a meal. Today the nations of the world are doing just that, around the circular tables of the United Nations General Assembly Hall.
That when we're dealing with the subject of the Antichrist, there is a lot of symbolism involved in it, religious symbolism, which needs to be interpreted. Have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.
الكلمة الآن للأمين العام للجامعة العربية صاحب السعادة نبيل العربي.
سيادة الرئيس.
Thank you, Mr. President.
اسمحوا لي أن أتقدم بالشكر.
Allow me, sir.
ولأعضاء المجلس على دعوتي للمشاركة في هذا الاجتماع الهام.
I've got an article here entitled Two Eminent Churchmen Agree.
Yes.
That there actually is, this is a shocker to a lot of people.
Yes.
That there are satanic practices going on at the Vatican. Could that be true?
Yes.
You want to say that? If I was a lawyer and you were on the witness chair, I'd say, would you say
it? It's out loud, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it is. Now, when we say in the Vatican, it's at a certain level. And there's no doubt about it that there have been and still are practices that are formally venerating Lucifer, the prince of this world. There's no doubt about that.
The people who are hanging out at the United Nations are just simply, in a nutshell, one word, they're Luciferian. And yeah, I'm just sorry to report that, but that's just what it is. And so all of the people today who are promoting the United Nations and the concept of world government, whether they know it or whether they don't, whether they're doing it for money or whether they're doing it for power or for whatever reason they're doing it, they are promoting the philosophy and the religion of the Antichrist.
In 1986, Pope John Paul II gathered in Assisi, Italy, the leaders of the world's major religions to pray for peace. There were snake worshippers, fire worshippers, spiritists, animists, Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus, North American witch doctors. I watched in astonishment as they walked to the microphone to pray. The Pope said they were all praying to the same God, and that their prayers were creating a spiritual energy that was bringing about a new climate for peace.
Robert McGinnis with the Family Research Council says it appears the hidden agenda is to unite people under one religious organization so they will peacefully accept UN goals such as population control, abortion rights, and one world government.
A new world order.
This ethnic cleansing that you're hearing about is Christian cleansing throughout the world. And as the Antichrist becomes more powerful, you're just simply going to see more and more and more of it. Now here, we have a picture of John Paul II hand in hand with the communist 33rd degree Mason, Nelson Mandela. So most all the blacks think that Nelson Mandela is the great black hope to South Africa. Here he is shaking hands with the communist Mikhail Gorbachev, who's also a Mason.
We are in the middle of spiritual warfare. But the point is that I think some of us at least are here because we realize that there's a real problem today. But the people who are on the outside looking in, this is not what they see. They're watching leadership of the Catholic Church meet with members of the Communist Party, like Togliatta in Italy. And they're asking themselves, how can this be? I think we're in the last days. How we got here is anybody's guess, I suppose.
Thank you.